Hey folks, Rob Ager here. Let's talk about cryptic details in The Terminator. Number one, The Terminator is supposedly a programmed machine without a will of its own, and yet it wears punk and biker outfits during this story. Now, these are outfits that we typically associate with rebellion. Is this just an incidental contradiction, or an indication that The Terminator does actually have a rebellious will of its own? Number two, as the love interest of the story, Sarah Connor's sexuality is mostly downplayed, especially in terms of how she dresses. But when she is approached by both the Terminator and Kyle Reese in the nightclub, a prominent extra in a red dress and tiger striped top is a dead ringer for Sarah, but a more sexualized version. Is this just coincidental? Number three, early in the film, a toy truck is crushed by the Terminator parking his stolen car. Writer-director Jim Cameron had been a truck driver before getting into filmmaking, so is this a statement about him escaping a former dead-end job and becoming a film director? But also, the shot starts with the camera following a young girl on her tricycle, and then the toy truck is hit. So, alternately, is this a suggestion about the Terminator being cold-blooded enough to kill children? Number four, the red and blue flash of police sirens are a major part of this movie's visual style. But the hunter-killer tractors in the future have police sirens on them too. You can see them at the back. The nightclub decor is also like a futuristic metallic prison complete with wire fences, and it has disco police lights embedded in the walls. So is this film just about the dangers of artificial intelligence, or is it also a warning against a future police state? Number five, in an opening scene, a Kyle Reese lookalike punk, complete with shotgun merchant long overcoat, gets his heart pulled out. Is the visual similarity between these two characters incidental, or is this an indication of the danger that the Terminator will pose to Kyle Reese as well as to Sarah Connor? Number six, we know that the Terminator can kill people quietly and easily by pulling their heart out, and yet it goes for a very noisy overkill of the first two Sarah Connors and the third Sarah Connor's roommate, Ginger. The first murder is committed with witnesses around in the street outside. And by killing the first two Sarah Connor victims in the exact same way and in their phone book order instead of by geographical distance, the Terminator alerts the police that they need to protect the third target. So, did the Terminator simply make logistical mistakes here, or is there another reason for these noisy overkills? Number seven, in many of the Terminator's appearances, it is accompanied by a very basic boom, 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 boom in the score. Does this represent the Terminator's machine-like heartbeat, or perhaps its tendency toward gunfire executions? Number eight, in a future scene, a mother and daughter look into a fire inside a broken TV, like the nuclear holocaust has been burned into their minds. But there's also an irony that they're getting warm from this fire. Was the irony intended? Number nine, Ginger's answer phone message says that machines need love too, and it's played twice in the film.
Hi there. I fooled you. You're talking to a machine. Machines need love too. So talk to it, and...
Is this just an ironic statement about the Terminator being devoid of emotion? Or is it an indication of the Terminator being more than just a programmed mechanism, like it does have feelings? Number 10, same question again, but different detail. The Terminator wears shades, obviously to hide its robotic eye, but it also comes off like it wants to look cool. Is this why it also preens its hair briefly before leaving the mirror? Number 11, we see in two scenes that the Terminator can do accurate voice impressions and can generate dialogue that just about passes for a mother's love for her daughter. And yet, its default voice is robotic and inhuman. Sure, Arnie has a limited voice range as an actor, but is the robotic voice and delivery a statement in itself, like the Terminator doesn't really want to pass for human? Number 12, the Terminator sees everything in red. Presumably this is some variation on infrared, although infrared photography isn't typically red and black as we see here. It's usually multicoloured, psychedelic looking, or sometimes just monochrome. The red visual system of the Terminator justifies its pupils being seen externally in red. So is the red coloration thematic, indicating the Terminator being angry or even representing spiritual evil? Note the godlike music here. Yeah. Number 13, along the same line of thought, we see the Terminator pull out a guy's heart, and Reese says,
"He'll wait for you, reach down her throat and pull her fucking heart out!"
Does the pulling out of hearts indicate spiritual evil, like taking away the victim's soul? Number 14, as the Terminator repeatedly fails to kill Sarah Connor, it seems to become less concerned with passing for human and less concerned with drawing attention to itself. Despite still wearing shades to hide its robotic eye, it walks about with guns out on open display. Is this supposedly emotionless machine becoming angry and frustrated? Number 15, in this shot, a sign for the hotel Sarah and Reese have been staying in boldly offers adult movies. Although our protagonists don't need that, they make an adult movie of their own. There's also a Spartan Burgers sign in shot in the background here, and the Terminator is Spartan in its physique. Reportedly, these were both real signs at the actual shooting location. They weren't created for the film. So is their appearance here just incidental, or did Jim Cameron recognise their relevance and take the opportunity to get them into the shot? Number 16, the Terminator sees Reese and Sarah together in a car and immediately attacks. And later on, it bursts into a room and shoots the bed where they just made love. And when they embrace after thinking they've killed it, it rises between them as if responding to their embrace. Does this robot hate the human concept of love? And number 17, Reese knew that John Connor's father dies before the war. He also knows that he is in love with Sarah before he even goes on the mission.
John Connor gave me a picture of you once. I didn't know why at the time.
Which in turn suggests that now he does know. So did Reese go on this mission privately knowing that he would become John Connor's father and thus die during the mission? Alright, so plenty to think about there in terms of deeper symbols and themes in the Terminator, and I've only scratched the surface. You've been listening to Rob Ager, and now, for the sake of balance, I'm going to hand over to my nemesis, Bogrier, who will offer his counter-arguments.
Hello, this is Bogrier, and I'm here to debunk all the bullshit film analysis stuff you just heard. I'm going to do it step by step. Number one, no, the Terminator does not wear punk and biker outfits as an expression of his form of rebellion. These costumes were totally incidental. We tried to find more normal costumes like jeans and t-shirts so that the Terminator would look completely normal among the crowd. But the only clothes we could find that were big enough for my beefcake physique happened to be punk and biker clothes. Number two, the hot chick in the red dress here was just put in there to give the film more sex appeal to the guys in the audience. She has nothing to do with the Sarah Connor at all, even though she is the only girl in the club with the same hairstyle. Number three, the Terminator running over the truck was my idea. We found that truck laying in the street when we were setting up the shot, and I just thought it would look cool for the Terminator robot to crush it like a beer can. The little girl on the tricycle wasn't even an extra. She was playing in the street where we were shooting, so we just let her be in the shot. Number four, the use of police sirens in the nightclub was just low budget. We had to smash up some cop cars in the chase, so we used their lights in the nightclub scene. And when we built these huge life-scale size hunter-killer tanks, we used them on there too. Number five, the punk guy is not intended to look like Kyle Reese, and there is definitely no gay subtext when he looks here at my package. But for some reason I just sounded Irish for a moment there. I apologise for that. Number six, the Terminator killed the two Sarah Connors with a noisy gun to conserve under battery power required to pull their hearts out. And it got its hands so messy with the punk it didn't want to have to do a hand clean-up job again. Number seven, the boom 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 music that accompanies the Terminator was just an accidental scoring, nothing to do with gunfire or robotic heartbeats. The composer was experimenting and accidentally put the four beats in like that. And it just sounded so good he sort of made it the Terminator theme whenever he's shown. Number 8. The mother and the little girl getting warm from a fire inside the TV set isn't saying anything about television broadcasts or their mental state, no. No, the TV just acts like a fireblocks place. No meta force going on there. Number 9. Ginger's answering machine saying machines need love too has nothing to do with the Terminator. It's just referring to the answer phone itself. Don't be stupid, Rob Ager. You're just reading too much into this film. Number 10, when the Terminator touches its hair, it doesn't say anything about this robot having an ego. When we recorded this shot, I thought it was a rehearsal, so I fixed my hair a little bit in the mirror. But then when they were editing, they lost the other takes and had no choice but to use this one. Edgar is just connecting dots that aren't even there to begin with. Number 11. Rob raises the point that the Terminator uses a robotic voice when it could easily generate a more natural sounding one, but this doesn't say anything about the Terminator as a character. I just didn't want my voice being dubbed like Darth Vader in the Star Wars. Number 12. The Terminator seeing everything in red and having red eyes has nothing to do with it being evil or angry or sexy. We just thought that since most of the movie is shot in cold blue, the red would make a nice contrast. Number 13. The Terminator pulling a guy's arse out has nothing to do with pulling out their soul. Souls are part of shoes and we don't wear shoes over our hearts. Number 14. The Terminator walking about with gun on display is not about it getting angry or caring less about blending into the crowd. The gun it has here is just too big to hide inside a leather jacket. Next thing, Rob will be saying the Terminator is a neo-Nazi because it intimidates a black guy here. Number 15. The adult movies and Spartan Burgers sign in this shot don't have any relevance, don't have nothing to do with the movie at all. Just like the Technoia sign doesn't say anything about the genre style of the movie. Just like the sign on the cop car reading to scare and project does not mean anything either. Remember, if it's not in the script, then it's not in the movie. Number 16, the Terminator is not jealous of Kyle Reese getting the girl and having the sweet love. It's just doing its job with no gender. And last point, number 17, the idea that Reese had figured out that he was John Connor's father and would die on the mission is very silly indeed. John Connor gave Reese the photography simply so he would recognize Sarah when he goes on the time travel mission. There's nothing more to it than that. I don't know what it is with these film analysts on YouTube. They're just trying to find phony stuff in classic movies to get higher view counts. It's all bullshit. The cabinet minister, the whole business. So whatever you do, don't go to this Rob Ager guy's website where he has all kinds of movie studies available for download from Platoon to They Live to The Exorcist to John Carpenter's Das Ding. Don't buy his downloads because you'll only encourage him to post more of this film study bullshit. And don't support him on Patreon or follow him on Facebook or Twitter. Instead, you should go watch one of the corporate film analysis channels who copy and paste most of their movie insights from original independent channels such as It's Just a Movie and We're Honestly Not Funded by a Movie Studio. These channels will give you the hardcore expert insight into deeper movies like Herbie Goes Bananas, I'm Gonna Get You Sucker, and The Warrior and the Blind Swordsman. So goodbye, folks, and remember, I'll be black. And no, that was not a racial joke. I was talking about the Terminator's famous biker costume, you idiots.